Hey, how's it going, guys? It's Nate here. And Skyrim is a tumultuous place. A land littered with war, dragons, and disease, the setting of The Elder Scrolls V seems plagued by chaos in every direction. But despite all these challenges, love can still find a way. Indeed, marriage is one potential path the Dragonborn may take that allows you to focus on something not quite as exciting as saving the world, but perhaps far more wholesome. A different kind of adventure, if you will. Dozens upon dozens of NPCs are available as candidates for marriage, but a handful stick out as particularly noteworthy, and it's some of those that I thought we'd cover today. Now, before we dive into this video, note that it will contain 3 possible wives and 2 possible husbands. And sometime eventually in the future, I'll probably do a part 2 that'll feature 2 wives and 3 husbands. That way, we're all hopefully able to satisfy everybody. Anyway, without further ado, let's do further. Starting off, frankly, we're kind of cheating here, with Mjoll the Lioness. She's a Nord warrior living in Riften, but oh boy, is she no ordinary adventurer. You see, as a child, Mjoll lost both of her parents when bandits attacked and destroyed her village. But unlike most people who would eventually find themselves living in an orphanage after something this horrible, Mjoll refused such a lifestyle, and instead became an adventurer, something her father had always wanted for his little girl. Obviously, a great number of years have passed since then, and her travels took her across Skyrim, and even beyond to other provinces, including Morrowind. But one day, as she was fighting her way through a dwarven ruin, the warrior was wounded by one of the machines, and barely managed to crawl her way out. She was found unconscious by a man named Aaron, and taken back to Riften, where she's been living for the past few months. Now Mjoll fancies herself as the city's protector. Losing her parents to criminals so long ago has embedded a deep hatred for all things evil in the woman, and she has a natural urge to help any who need it. Just follow her around the settlement, if only for a little while, and you can listen as she donates to beggars, checks up on shopkeepers, and attempts to root out Thieves Guild and Blackbriar influence.
Aaron tells me you might be dealing arms to the Thieves Guild. Is this true?
I don't know what he's talking about. He must be seeing things.
I'm watching you, Grelka. One slip up, and I report you to the guards. You got that? Have you prepared the stables like I suggested, Shadr?
Yes, Lady Mjoll. If Riften gets attacked, we'll retreat inside the city gates and bar the door just like you said.
Good. You could be our first line of defense since you live outside the city walls, so we're depending on you. Madesi, my friend, how have things been since last week's incident?
Ever since you scared off that thug from the Thieves Guild, not one of them's bothered me. We're lucky to have you here.
It's my pleasure. If you see the Thieves Guild harassing anyone else, you be sure and let me know.
She has the moral compass of Superman. After the player has surpassed level 14, she can offer you a quest to venture into that dwarven ruin she was injured in so long ago, and recover Grimserver, a sword she left behind. Do so, and Mjoll the Lioness will become both a candidate for marriage and a potential follower. So not only do you get a spouse with a similar background in adventuring, who you know will be able to protect the house when you're gone, but also a quite literal companion. Ah, but there's just one minor loose end you may want to look into. Remember that Aaron guy, the person who nursed her back to health after she was nearly killed in that ruin? Well, if you're the jealous type, you might want to do something about him. The two are extremely close, best friends. And when you marry Mjoll, there's a chance Aaron may follow her to your house and either just occasionally stop by, or legitimately start living there. Now, this seems to just be a minor bug with his pathfinding, as Aaron is scripted to follow Mjoll around Riften a lot, and if she moves into your home, those scripts don't go away. So he keeps trying to follow her anyway. But still, I get we're the Dragonborn, but maybe we should still keep an eye on that guy she's telling us not to worry about. Next on our list, for all the lovely ladies and a few gentlemen out there, meet Sorex Vinius. He's an Imperial man living and working out of the Winking Skeever Inn and Tavern in Solitude. After delivering some drinks for him to the Blue Palace, he becomes an option for marriage. At first, Sorex seems relatively unremarkable for a citizen of Solitude. But after a bit of attention is paid to the fellow, it's obvious he's a good suitor. For one, he's not just a worker at the Winking Skeever. His father, Corpulus, is indeed the owner. and confidently asserts that he'll give the business to Sorix upon his retirement. However, it's suggested that Sorix is already pretty much managing and running the place as is. So his father's promises aren't a big deal to him. Sorix also implies that he doesn't really want to spend the rest of his life working here. In a conversation that can be overheard between him and his father, Sorix admits that there's a whole world out there that he sort of wants to see. And working at the Winking Skeever for the rest of his life might not be what he wants.
It's been a good week, my boy. Loud customers mean good cheer, and good cheer means a full till. You know, I had to retire and leave you to run the Skeever, son.
I don't know, Father. There's a whole world out there I want to see.
On top of his deep desire for exploration, Sorix is also one of only a few NPCs who will stick up for characters he cares about. You see, should the player attack, but not kill, any person whom Sorix has a positive disposition with, be it his father, sister, or even a friend, later on in the game, he may track down and confront the Dragonborn to demand that you apologize and swear to never harm that person again.
Here's the situation. You attacked my family. So now you're going to apologize or I'm going to kill you. I hope we understand each other. Perhaps I haven't made myself clear. Your best and least painful course of action is to apologize and promise to leave my family in peace.
So, the heir to a profitable business, curious for adventure, and willing to stick up for those he loves. What more could you ask for? Well, I haven't even told you the best part yet. You see, Sorix knows dad jokes.
You know, the Winking Skeever's not just the best inn in Solitude. It's also the only inn in Solitude. Nah.
So there you go, ladies and gentlemen. The full and complete package. I don't see how you could go wrong with this one. Coming in at number 3, Morwen is a Nord member of the Skull Tribe living on the island of Solstheim. She plays a relatively minor role in the Dragonborn DLC questline, simply being present for some of the affairs that take place at her village. Though, if you speak to her, it'll quickly become obvious that Morwen isn't like most of her fellow Skull. She's actually not from Solstheim, but instead, Falkreath. You know, the hold in Skyrim. She explains that before she was born, her father was a sailor, who lived in Skyrim, but sailed all across the Sea of Ghosts. One day he was wrecked on the coast of Solstheim, though was rescued by a Skull woman. The two quickly fell in love, and when the time came for the man to return to Skyrim, he just decided to bring that woman with him, and they settled down in Falkreath and had Morwen. After many years, her parents passed away, and Morwen decided to move to Solstheim to be with her mother's old tribe. She'll give you a short quest to deliver a necklace to Falkreath's head priest, and after you've done that, Morwen can be married. From there, should you decide to move in with her, you can ultimately choose to settle down in Skyrim, bringing her back once again to the land which she was born. Funnily enough though, she's one of only two other potential spouses that can live with you on Solstheim, as the only player home on the island is Severin Manor, and for whatever reason, spouses and children can't be moved in there. But since Morwen has a house of her own on the landmass, the Dragonborn can just choose to move in with her directly. So, decisions, I guess. For fourth spot, we have our first and only Mer on this list. Sundas Drenim, a Dunmer miner living in the small mining community of Darkwater Crossing. He spends most of his days chopping away at rocks and evenings sitting by a campfire swapping stories with his fellow workers and the settlement's inhabitants. If you take the time to listen to some of the dialogue he has with other NPCs, it will become apparent that Sundas is a surprisingly wholesome character. Apparently, he's become something of a father figure to a little girl named Hrefna, who lost her own father long ago and is now being raised by a single working mother.
Thanks for looking after Hrefna.
Oh, it's no trouble. She's a smart little girl. Might talk your ear off, but she's fun.
Well, I know she thinks the world of you.
Well, I'll try to be a good influence then.
Sundas takes care of me when Mom's not around.
Additionally, if you speak to Sundas for yourself, his experience and compassion becomes even more evident, as he tells you he's been mining for over 100 years, but only started working at this one a few years back. Recently, the miners here have developed coughs and signs of some sort of disease. The elf admits that he's seen such a thing before, and knows the sickness is the result of ore dust in the air. He took it upon himself to order some medicine from Windhelm, which the Dunmer plans to pick up soon. From here, the Dovahkiin can offer to go get and return the medicine to him, beginning a quick miscellaneous quest that, once you complete, will make Sundas marriageable. I know I used this word earlier when describing him, but after thinking about it, this guy is genuinely among the most wholesome NPCs in the game. And it's quite nice to know that even in a world as brutal as the one the Elder Scrolls V thrusts us in, plagued by war and apocalyptic prophecies, there's still a few people out there who haven't let the struggles get the best of them. And finally, last on our list, this one may actually be my favorite. I give you Terry. She's an Altmer resident of Solitude, and co-owner of its clothing store, The Radiant Raiment, which she runs with her sister. Terry is the only High Elf available for marriage without consul commands, so she's already got that going for her. But honestly, I find her personality to be absolutely hilarious. The thing about her is that she's insanely rude to people, but not on purpose. Whenever you engage in dialogue with her, at least before your marriage, she'll usually insult you. But again, she doesn't do this on purpose. She sort of seems to think she's just being straight up, and actually believes she's doing you a favor.
We provide clothing for all of Solitude's most influential residents. But for you, I'll make an exception. If you're heading to the Blue Palace, you might want to rethink that outfit.
She doesn't mean to be mean to you, she just sort of is by accident, and I find that to be amazing. That said, some of the dialogue she can engage in with her sister is particularly belligerent. Take a listen.
Sister dear, could you try sewing these sleeves a little tighter? We can't have our customers looking sloppy because of your work. Oh, certainly, dear sister. We couldn't afford to have our customers look like the simple pigs they are, now could we? Good. And while you're at it, perhaps you could sew your mouth shut when our fine customers are within earshot,
But beneath all of these relatively belligerent remarks, there is a pretty good personality. Terry does make an effort to be nice to the player. After realizing she's insulted you in some of her dialogue sequences, she'll sort of apologize and try and deliver a compliment. Furthermore, she may even remark that she hopes you stay in the City of Solitude, as the city could use some new blood. And she's not that hard to win over. All you need to do is deliver a dress she had custom made to Solitude's Blue Palace in order for her to become a potential candidate for marriage. So Terry may not be some warrior or vigilante hero, but no one can deny that she is quite the unique personality. Plus, she also owns a business. So go ahead and shoot your shot. And with that, we're going to wrap up my top 5 spouses in The Elder Scrolls V Skyrim. I did my best to try and include characters in this video that I didn't see in similar ones, and also try and focus on the contents of their personalities or their own characters, rather than stats or anything to that effect. So let me know how you think I did, and what are your own personal favorite husbands or wives that I didn't get a chance to tackle in this video? As mentioned, I intend to do a part 2. Anyway, thanks for watching, everybody. As always, like ratings are very much appreciated, and I hope to catch you all in my next video. Peace out, everyone.